नमस्ते. थैंक यू सुमा, थैंक यू कार्तिकेयन सर, थैंक यू आदित्य, एंड थैंक्स टू लाइफ पॉजिटिव. एक्चुअली आई बीन एसोसिएटेड विथ लाइफ पॉजिटिव बाय डिफॉल्ट सिंस मेनी इयर्स नाउ, बट ऑफ एंड ऑन देर हैज ऑलवेज बीन अ कम्युनिकेशन वेदर आई एम इन इंडिया और आउटसाइड. सो इट्स लाइक अ नेचुरल थिंग फॉर मी टू बी हियर. सो आई फील दैट this is a flow which is continuing for some time, and I wish life positive many more years to years of success and presence in the not only Indian soil but everywhere. As Karthikeyan sir was saying, I wrote about it in the magazine also. The truthful representations are missing these days. Compromises are too many. So there is always a twisted or probably a concocted message which is given to the people, while spirituality also has been interpreted in a way where it's dividing people today. I always believe that we should never mix religion and spirituality together, because religion is a method to become spiritual. These are methods. Various people have found various methods to reach levels of elevation, and if we mix these two, there is a lot of distortion and people do not understand. So a magazine like Life Positive, because of various perspectives, I think gives a large amount of clarity to the people on what is real and what is unreal. Then it is up to the people to choose. People can choose only as per their level of awareness. They cannot choose anything bigger than that. So having said that, today I would like to start the program. I think we start with the meditation, and then we have time up to 1 o'clock, I feel, right? 12:30 or 1 o'clock. So let's start with the meditation. This is basically to equalize the energy, the frequencies. Then I'll answer questions. Rajesh, shall we? Meditation? Yeah. A breathing which is of 5 levels. Imagine the 5 gears of a car. The first gear, 10 kilometer speed. Second, 20 kilometer. Third gear, 30 kilometer. Fourth gear, 40 kilometer. And fifth gear, any speed. So what I would like you to do is that breathe from the root of your spine all the way to the top of the head, and imagine there is a hole on top of the head, and breathe out through this and breathe in and come to all the way to the root of the spine. This speed I will say increase then first to second to third to fourth to fifth. Fifth you have to really breathe fast, and then I will bring you to your lungs, and you have to be aware of the lungs and feel the lungs, and I will guide you on that. So are we ready? So root of the spine, top of the head, a hole on top of the head, and you're breathing out through this. This is the way you breathe. Ready? Any questions? Keep your... No, just smoothly you take it up from the root of the spine all the way through that hole here, all the way up, and then as much as you like, I mean as much as your lungs can handle, up and down, and breathe in your pace, but 10 kilometer, 20, 30, 40, and then at any pace. Ready? Spine erect, eyes closed, start in first gear. Up and down. Be very relaxed. You're going in very, very, very slow speed. On through the hole on top of your head. breathe from your stomach like Kapalbhati, pump it out as fast as you could through the top of the head, pump it out. Very slowly, feel the breath, cool yourself down. Now bring your awareness to your lungs, cool and as quiet as possible. The lungs should not know that you're breathing, that quiet. Be with your lungs completely. Feel the stillness, tranquility. Your lungs are not knowing that you're breathing. That level of tranquility, shanti, perfect peace. In that mood, just follow into the guided meditation. Sit in a comfortable position. Please keep your spine erect. Gently close your eyes. And do not open them till I tell you to. Keep your hands stretched on your knees in Chin Mudra, which connects the tip of the thumb and index finger, while all the other three fingers open. Take 10 deep breaths slowly. Please do not hold the breath. Breathe in and breathe out slowly. Please be aware of your inhalation and exhalation.
spend a few moments being aware of the sensations within.
Now, you are visualizing your teachers or acharyas or gurus, all those lovely masters who guided you in life. As they come floating into your mind, you thank them wholeheartedly, deeply. You visualize the God that you worship. Even if the God is formless, you thank the divine energy wholeheartedly, deeply, filled with gratitude. They are floating through your mind, in and out, gracefully, after stopping in front of you to bless you. All of them are peaceful and happy. As they float in, silently thank them deeply and wholeheartedly. You are just watching them, thankfully, as they enter and exit your mind. As each of them, peaceful and loud. Time. Don't be in a hurry. As you are experiencing this wonderful sensation, you are feeling more and more complete and satisfied. Now, please take your attention to your spine. Be aware of your in 360 degrees with spine at the center. Being aware of this state, gently, silently thank everything, every object that helped you to live on earth, including the food you have consumed so far, clothes that you wore, houses that sheltered you, the money that passed through your hand, your bed and all other materials that you used, all people who served you till now and will serve you in the future. Even if you cannot remember them, please express your gratitude to all of them and be deeply aware that without these objects and people, life on earth would not have been possible for you.
focus your attention on your forehead. Try to concentrate on the space between your eyebrows. Do not force anything. Chant this affirmation silently in your mind deeply. May deep peacefulness flourish within me and outside of me. May happiness and bliss flourish within me and outside of me. I am filled with love for everything, and everything loves me. I am a well-balanced personality. I have no fears nor hatreds. I give love and only love in all adversities and difficult times. My world is filled with love, and I love everybody. I know that I am the pure spirit, and I have no enemies. Being pure spirit and part of the universal spirit, I bless all beings. I bless one and every with unconditional love, peace, and happiness. Are starting to express the true nature of the Almighty. You are feeling the divine white light flowing over you, into you, and enveloping you. Now, once again, start visualizing the face of your gurus or teachers or acharyas as they float into your mind. Stopping for a few moments in front of you to receive your blessings. Feel the divine energy from your palm flowing into your teachers and enveloping them. You bless your teachers wholeheartedly with limitless love and gratitude. Negative emotions lying in your mind from the past. With this meditation, they have left you completely. You will not feel any more stress hereafter, as you know that you are the pure divine spirit. You will always feel yourself in 360 degrees circle, and you will always feel yourself as embodiment of pure love. You have cleansed yourself completely. Slowly bring your right hand back to Chin Mudra, placed over your right knee. For the next 5 minutes, just enjoy the peacefulness and purity of the new you. Be with your soul fully. Do not let your mind stray outside. Just rub your palms 3 times. Give the energy to your eyes, your face, and your whole body. Do it 3 times. Just keep your eyes closed for 1 more minute. Feel yourself. Feel the energy. Feel the tranquility. Feel the inner silence. When you are totally absorbed inside, there are no anxieties, there are no fears, there is no world outside. When all your senses and your mind are looking within, you are as peaceful as you can be. Slowly open your eyes. Are you in a mood to speak? It's difficult to talk after the tranquility, because to bring yourself out to speak, it takes effort. So what is effortless is being you. When you have to become something else or somebody else, it takes effort. That's the violence that we feel every day in life. There is a bit of violence when you try to become something. What you are essentially is effortless. So that's what we experience. This meditation was basically to purify yourself. When you remove all the clutter, the energy flows beautifully. There are no calamities, there is no energy blockages, and also there's no effort. So when we try to become something else, every day, every point in time, we're trying to prove something to the world, or we're trying to be on an action mode. So when we move to the action mode, there is always an effort. But when you are totally within, and then whatever actions happen outside, when you are not so attached to it, not even connected to it on an emotional plane, then it's all smooth and flowing. This is what we see. This is exactly what Lord Krishna said to Arjuna also. When you do not get attached to the fruits of action, you don't have any sin about it, or you don't have any connection. So when you're connected to the activity, or when you're doing your activity without being
connected to the result of the activity, you are free. So this is freedom. Liberation is every moment. Liberation is not when you leave the body. Liberation is a state when you are always within yourself and you are absolutely in a unruffled, peaceful mode in all your life, all your activities, in the waking state. This is the mode. I'll take your questions now. Do we have a break or we continue? Would you like to have a break? Okay. How many minutes?
He was looking into my eyes and talking for some time. I became totally blank. I had no questions to ask, nothing. I became totally blank and I had various programs further down. I almost called up the people and tried to cancel all the programs because I didn't want to interact with the public. This man, with his presence, with his connection into the eyes, he sucked out my mind completely. You know, and this is the extreme. I'm giving you this example only to tell an extreme level where an impression itself is stopped in the root level. And then I asked him, I mean, actually we discussed, so I said, this is your last life. He said, no, mother said you have to come back again because you have certain things to do. You'll be back again in a body for some time. So he knows that very well, that he is going to come back, but he's going empty already. And then even when he comes back in that mode, you will be coming back empty. There'll be nothing, no agenda. Then how will you take a birth? Only for the purpose of dharma, duty, conscious, truthful, duty. If you take a birth of that level at some point in time, then what you do is only with the divine order. There is no plan for myself. But what happens through the body, through the constitution, is for the benefit of the world. That kind of birth can happen. So if you understand that is a possibility, just like, for example, Jesus' birth. You know, his practical or fruitful years, let's call it fruitful years. Of course, he lived for about 32 years. But the effective years are about 8 years. That's the only time that he contributed to the world. What we read today in the Bible are impressions of the disciples. You know, but his 8 years were impactful and fully passionate because only the purpose was leading it, not an agenda. If you have a personal agenda, it cannot have that passion. If purpose is leading the show, there is always energy, there is always a dynamic in it, because it's impersonal. So this is one extreme. So now we get back to this question, where why certain things are happening, because it's all getting stored in the mental level, substrate, mind, ego, intellect. This level it is getting stored. It is called intellectual obesity. It's an obesity. You know, you become quite fat in the mind because you have so much of data input. Now, to unlearn, it takes time. So what you need to do, you need to understand all these ideas, all these concepts, all this knowledge, and all the people associated with it. Even people are sometimes bothersome. Not exactly that way, but you know, they remind you of certain things. So minus all this, there is something called you, which is not affected by any of this. These are all like your dress, shirt, sari or blouse or all this kind of thing. But beyond all this, there is somebody called you, who's not affected by any of these things. And if you are able to try to connect to that, that person has no agenda. There's nothing, no plan, no agenda, and no pressure to think, no pressure to talk, nor any pressure to act. But at the same time, because you have a body, because you have a mind, because you have an intellect, you are acting, you are feeling, and you are thinking. If you are able to identify that person who is nothing, that means you need to probably get away from all this and connect to this person within you, the real person, the real you. And sometimes this person has no face. So even your identifications and identities, your personalities may not impact that person. You know? So if you are able to connect to that person, all these things drop off. Then you feel, oh, okay, me and you are one. That way you are able to see, there is nothing to know. Then what you feel or what you see is from inside. This person is projecting it. So if you want to have an experience outside, it is already an experience inside. It's already happened. But you may see its manifestation outside. This is where I was explaining to one person earlier that you go through this process where you stop storing impressions. The causal layer is empty. The impressions itself is not stored because there's no impressions to store. There's no impression. You are involved in an activity, and that activity is happening, at the same time you are not the activity, nor the witness, nor the experiencer. This is a spontaneous state. I'm telling you, it's not, you can't create this state. This thing inside, you cannot create. You become that. So you are absolutely in the activity, you are fully there, but at the same time, you are not at all involved in it. But if you ask, oh, did you have the ice cream? Yes, I had the ice cream, it was very tasty. I loved it. So somebody liked it, but at the same time, you are not attached to the ice cream, nor the taste, nor the impression of it. So nothing stores. So this is what they say, like water on the lotus leaf. Every activity will come and it stay and it will not get connected to the leaf and it will drop off. So this integration is a spontaneous thing provided you stop thinking, stop acting, and be aware. So even if you go for any programs, any gurus or any book knowledge reading, it doesn't matter. Everything will come and go, and you will be completely free. Freedom is a state where you need nothing. If you have even one requirement, you are not free. You are a slave to that requirement. So freedom is a state which is already in you. Nobody, don't think that gurus are doing a great work in the world. They're just road signs. You know, if you go to a guru, why people go, of course, many people go to a guru out of insecurity. That's a different story. I don't normally endorse it. I always feel that people come to me with insecurity, then I'm not doing my job well. If I cannot empower somebody, then I'm useless. So, people who go to a guru, like for example, people go to Kailas. Why do we take, it's a very, very tough journey. Those who have gone to Kailas knows it's not easy. Why do we go to Kailas? It's the aspiration of the mind to be still, or aspiration of the man for the stillness. Kailas is equal to stillness. That is after the third eye, the Bindu Bodhini Kailas state, where you are after the explosion of consciousness. The Kailas is a place where everything comes back to one dot, the Bindu in the center of the Sri Chakra. This state happens, that means you are Shiva. This is why we are going there. What? To witness the state of being in full bliss. And it will not happen if you are going to see Kailas. You have to feel Kailas. You have to be Kailas. And that state automatically happens when the guna goes to nirguna. Nirguna means there is nothing you can do about it. You can, with your practices, you can only reach up to third eye. Then it becomes nirguna. So what I am saying is that all these things happen by itself, provided you are not cramming it in. When activity takes over, beingness drops. When beingness develops, activity drops. Activity dropping is not completely away from everything. You're not going to Himalayas or caves or anything. But activity will become an expression or an extension of you. Then all these things are finished. You see? This is how it works. So, did I confuse you or did I clarify this?
It's still intellectual.
Intellectual. That is our nature. Because that's the constitution you created. We try to understand God through our brain. You know, that is why the religions or dogmas are given to people. He said, this is God. Like one great scholar was walking and he had a servant following him. So he was always talking about Parabrahma, Supreme Consciousness. So this servant asked him, what exactly is Supreme Consciousness you're talking about? So this man thought, this is an idiot. What do I tell you about Supreme Consciousness? Then he said, did you see that buffalo? That is Supreme Consciousness. So, you know, let him get stuck with some image, let him be there. And then they were continued to walk. But this guy, he meditated on Supreme Consciousness as a buffalo, without the knowledge of the guru. And after some time, they were going through a narrow street, and this guy is not coming. They said, why are you standing there? He said, I don't get this buffalo through. Then he realized, in subtle form, he made Parabrahma into a buffalo with his sadhana. So it is possible, you can have any image or impression you like about the Supreme Consciousness, because that is you. It's your projection. It's how you are and how you want it to be. You see? So this is the way it is. So what we are, that is the projection we get. So you must stop being you.
How But that seems very difficult.
No, that is why I said step by step. You know?
Right.
Yeah, that is why I said, you know, step by step. Whatever is happening in the mind, understand it's happening in the mind. And you know, see something like, I have a concept of a guru. This is how a guru should be. That's not me. Immediately, that's not me. Bundle it out, throw it away. Like that, each and everything coming, you are witnessing and you are discarding. Finally, you reach a state of emptiness where none of these concepts are binding you. You start feeling none of these things are important. So this is like a conscious meditation, full time, because it happens all the time in the waking state. And you keep on discarding, then you finally reach a level of emptiness. So this is a constant. And at that point in time, you will always be alert. Then you lose your identities. It also erodes. Because am I this anger? You know, it's not me. Pluck the anger out and throw. It's a mental exercise. It's like a visualization. It's like a exercise. But then what happens in the Bahe? You are actually cutting off things from your system. And then finally it starts dropping. And when it completely drops, that's when you start feeling the full freedom. You say, oh, okay. So I was always free. I never knew this because concepts were binding me. This is everybody's journey. Yeah. And then the reality starts happening. One shift from this substratum to backwards to subtle, you know, you'll see the whole world in a different light. Completely different.
One shift is the problem.
That takes effort.
No, there is also a stimulus which makes you react in a different way.
Correct.
Or you get angry.
That is the
somebody says something, I get angry.
Yeah.
Or we bundle it and throw it out.
Absolutely. This is exactly what I said. This is triggered by the impression. You know, you have created that impression and it's already inside. It may not be from this life also. You might have brought this character constitution from another or two lives. So when it is there, first is be aware. At a particular situation, in a particular given situation, time, space, I become agitated or I become angry. I am not this anger because there is somebody who is not angry when I am angry. So you start making friendship with that person who is not angry when you are angry. You know, it's an exercise. It's like a meditation. That's what I'm saying. Instead of going outside into the forces, you go within and start doing this thing more and more. Because outside it's actually entertaining the mind. When you go for courses, programs and all these things, mostly that is entertainment to the mind. You mind for some time feels, okay, I learned something. But again, you are still the same. So unless there is a shift in the mind or a shift in your awareness, basically it's not the mind. Only when mind leaves, awareness is full. So unless there's a shift, so you need to concentrate more on that awareness level. Being conscious of your consciousness. Being conscious of your state where you are not affected. You will reach a state where you are not affected by anything. And that's a process. It can happen in one lifetime for sure. That is why somebody asked Buddha, how can we be like you? So he said, very simple. Start meditating. You know, hours on. Do severe penance. He said, no, it's not possible. There are a lot of other things to do. Then he said, serve the Guru. So Guru will beat you up, you know. True Gurus are unpredictable. So when you serve, you are constantly in the present, and also you are actually dealing with unpredictability. A true Guru, I'm saying Satguru. So the unpredictability. Then what happens? Every time your theory or your idea of having a frame gets broken. Consistently, if your frames are broken, what is remaining? Then what remains is your core. Because you easy to create, like mind likes to have frames. I know this person. We always say that. I know this person. Nobody knows anybody. Actually, reality. Nobody can know anybody. It's impossible to know. Because a person has three states already. Waking state, dream state, deep sleep state. In these three states, we only see a person and a personality during waking state. That too, in a particular light. We can never know the person. Even if we are living together, what is the constitution we can never see. So all these things will drop off. We will, like a child, we look at a person as a fresh toy or a fresh being.
And then when we work with the person, or when we connect to the person, it's always fresh. You know, so the concept-based or a prejudiced approach will drop off by itself. So everything is fun. So being agitated to a particular situation has always a root, and fundamentally it's impression, and in the second layer it's expectation. See, I expect that when I switch on the switch, there should be light. The moment I switch on and there's no light, I become agitated, because what was the problem? I had an expectation. So you will come down to the level of expectation while both possibilities are there, and it's fine. You know, if I switch on, sometimes the light may not be there. It is okay. And then what is the next alternative? So I do it this way. So the flexibility level will be very high. When your flexibility is very high, your impact of the wear and tear will be very less. Otherwise, we are rigid. We're very, very rigid. This should be like that. This person should behave like this. The situation should be like this. This book should have this value. This place should have this value. If I have to spend time, there should be a reason. All these things. So the cause and the effect thing will be very harsh on you. Otherwise, it will be okay. It's happening. And the flexibility and the flow like a river, you know, that thing will be more. So that when you have more flexibility, your liberation is easier. So that you will not feel much about it. Like, for example, one person comes to you and behaves with you in not so appropriate way. So why that person has that inclination to behave with you? There will be some reason for it. So if you are in a state of samadhi, where you are in a samitarka samadhi, like a state where you have a problem or a question and you must have an answer, otherwise your mind is not peaceful. That is the state where most of us exist. From there we shift to nirvitarka. You have a situation, a state, you know there is an answer, but you are not worried about the answer. So this is the first level you come to, is that, okay, there is an answer for everything, but it doesn't matter to me. So that you start accepting yourself much more. If you really, really, really analyze, most of the conflicts that we experience is because we do not accept ourselves, not other people. Yeah, we have not really shaken hands shook hands with ourselves really well, you know, because we always been looking outside and we actually believe what others think about us. You know, we married it without even thinking whether is this true, is this me. You know, people always royals or the people who made history, they create the histories which makes them beautiful. You know, whatever the history is, it doesn't matter. But you should look good. Like that, we all always like to feel good. But then sometimes it's better to know the reality rather than feeling good. Because if you always try to wear a mask, the reality is different. And then you cannot be liberated. You need to know the naked you, the real you. Beyond all the masks, beyond all the concepts, beyond all these things which are displayed outside, beyond the personality, there is something which is the core of you. Actually, that person is not affected by any of these projections. So, this is the answer. We need to accept, for which we need to be flexible. You know, flexibility, acceptance is equal to liberation. We go to liberation. That is a daily life liberation. We need to be liberated each moment, for which the flexibility. And flexibility should not happen because a moment he said, so I should be flexible. Not like that. You know, it is that flexibility should be your nature, because you are able to accept yourself.
Well, later on, because they have been original, they have not been contaminated. But those who are very good in academic, etc., are extremely mediocre, because they can only work within frames. You know, we see that in daily life. It's all within frames. And why it is so? Because it's the easiest thing to do. Borrow the frames and sit inside. It's easy, very easy. But to create your own path, impossible, very difficult. And also, you are exposed to all these situations of the world, all the situations, and it's not always kind. It's not kind. They are sometimes very cruel to you. That's what makes you. When the world is not so kind, that makes you. That makes you powerful. Because you have no choice. You have to survive. Survive in this is not in the negative sense, like to kill somebody and survive. The thing is that you have to increase your metal. You have to pump more iron. You know, this is good. I believe it is very good. That if you are not ordinary, it's good. People may not accept you, but it is good because you are being original. Very few people are original in this world. Out of 7.3 billion people, how many are original? You know, looking good, feeling good, smelling good. This is what you're looking at. Instead, be you. If somebody wants to accept you the way you are, then they are real friends for you. They are real for you. These people are real. These are the only people who matters. The others are just, you know, they come and go. Did I answer this question? I hope I removed the confusion of it. How to overcome prarabdha and experience free will, if any, to uplift oneself? Yeah, it's really a good question. Prarabdha is what made you. Prarabdha means the desires which were unfulfilled, brought you to a new incarnation. So the reason for the incarnation is our desires which are not complete. You must experience them. So how do you finish prarabdha? Experience them. Fulfillment is the first level of removing prarabdha. Then second, there are certain evolution happening while we are experiencing. For example, there are two levels, there are many levels where you can have a human existence. I'm sure everybody knows this because you are not new to spirituality. But I'll just brief it just for the sake of clarity. One is the evolutionary, from animal to human, and then through the human experiences, you evolve to the saint and saint to God. This is the natural process, organic growth. That is, when an animal evolves into a level where you attain a human body, you will still be 98% animal and 2% human in the beginning. Then through various incarnations, you increase your humanness. That you can see in the society. You look at the society. Some people are very animalistic, and then there are people very evolved also. So in the process, you have taken various bodies, and this is also said. This is also explained clearly in the Devi Puran, Puran of Goddess. It is clearly mentioned. So I'm just briefing it. So in the process, you take various incarnations, and you reach a level where you are 90% human and 10% animal. Then again, you grow into become 100% human. When you become 100% human, your only operating level will be love, unconditional love. There's nothing else in you because you have no dualities. You know, but on all the other levels where you have partially animal characteristics, then you will always be playing with the duality much more, right? And there will be greed, anger, possessiveness. All these things will be mixture. And then when you reach the human, 100% human, then you are more inclined into the higher awareness. You want to feel higher awareness. You are kind by nature, compassionate by nature. Then you reach a sane state, a state where none of these things are really, really important. And you are in a centered level where you want to express your kindness in a more powerful way. Then you become a saint. And from the saint, you aspire for godhood, because you even diminish the humanness to a level where it's diminishing means it's not a practical thing. It's through awareness. Only through awareness you can diminish any states. Please understand this clearly. Awareness is the key, and awareness is the path, and awareness is the method to diminish all your character traits, personality traits, to a level where you become one with the God particle or God state of God. So when you reach that state, then even your body will not matter. This is what we call the Nirbija Samadhi kind of state, where even a seed is not existing. Not even a seed. Not even an element of the qualities which created you as a human is not there. This is why you can see some of the saints, if you feed them, they eat. Like Avadudas. They will be lying on the side of the road. If you give food in the mouth, they eat, because they are not worried about food. They are not worried about body. They are not connected to body. So they stay on for days in a complete bliss state of being one with the consciousness. And sometimes people brush their teeth. Then they brush the teeth, because they don't have any initiative for that, because they are not worried about any of these things. And then if you give food, they eat food. Those people, when they leave the body also, the chaitanya, the energy, still stays in the body. These are many of the jiva samadhis are like that. These are the power centers of today. Like why people, all the people go to Shirdi? Because the master was existing in the body still, and is still existing in the body. Because when they leave the body, they are just making a shift from one unit to the universe. That's it. A unit to the universe is the shift. And this shift happens because you are already completely occupied in the body and outside the body at the same time, while alive and while leaving. So we will reach a state of that level. So when you are in the levels beyond the human, there is no prarabdha. Once you reach a state of saint and you already diminished all your vasanas, the inclinations, impressions, and also desires, then you are already beyond prarabdha. So how do we overcome prarabdha? Through awareness. That is the answer. One word answer is through awareness. And when you are aware of you being an incarnation just produced for the sake of fulfilling the desires, you will go through all your desires which is laid out on time. Please understand, this is from your first heartbeat till your last heartbeat. It's laid out on time. And it will only happen at a particular time. What you will experience at the age of 60 cannot be experienced at the age of 58. Sure. So you will only experience a particular aspect of your existence at a particular time. This is what we call the time-space junction point. A particular thing will happen only at a particular place, to a particular person, or at a particular time. Time-space junction. That will be totally done. This is 100% prarabdha. It's not at all your free will. You don't have free will. You chose this. Otherwise, how do you sit here today? You know, 10 years ago, you never chose that you will be sitting here now. We never decided to meet last week, right? Or last year. We never knew that we are going to meet. This is what we call the thrust of prarabdha, which is laid out on time. At this point in time, this event has to happen for this set of people. Yeah. So once you clearly understand that, then you know where is the free will aspect in it. Free will aspect is your experience aspect. Understand this clearly. This is the experience. If you are totally agitated now and sitting here, you will only get partially. For example, you are already prejudiced. You have attended various programs or various gurus' talks, and you have come with a prejudice that, oh, this fellow, what is he going to say? Then you will not listen to me. You are only comparing in your mind. So you miss the subject. That is why it is said, like the Zen philosophy, it always says, go always with an empty glass. Never go with a full cup. Because if this is empty, I can fill this up. If it is already full, I can give nothing. I can put nothing in it. So value is depending on how much you are able to empty yourself to receive. This is the point. So that is the free will. This is the free will. Your capacity for your receptivity or your capacity to receive is your free will. That is at a given point. Given point in time is not your free will. This is your prarabdha. Did I make myself clear? What you are here now is prarabdha. What is your capacity for receptivity is the free will. This is something which you should understand. Once you understand that, you will have no calamity. There will be no confusion. There will be no conflict. Because you already know that the only requirement is emptiness. In life, not only here, in life, the only need for you to experience life is emptiness. That means be empty at every point in time, so you can get filled in, again empty, fill in, so that you are always remaining empty. This is the very, very, very big reason for easy liberation, or the cause, or the path for effortless liberation. Being empty at every point in time, effortlessly. So when you go to, now the another program is happening after this. You should go to that guru empty, so that whatever she or he gives, you can actually accept. Don't go, oh, Mohanji said this, so this guru now, what is she going to say? Never think like that. Everybody in this world has value. All these people have value. They have all been created for a purpose. So all people have value. Now what you can get out of it, we don't know. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. But when you go approach any person, any guru, I would say even when you approach a small child, you should go empty. Because the child gives you so much. You know, at least it will tell you how to be in the present. Right? So everybody is a world is a whole, guru is not a human being. Guru is a situation. Guru is a moment. Guru is a time. Guru is your life. Guru is your situation. You know, everything is guru. So if you are able to see that in life, you have seen everything. And understand, by going to one place or going to a particular guru, nothing happens if there is no capacity. If there is no empty space inside, wherever you go, you are the same. This is why there is no change happening. Transformation is not happening because there is no space to transform. Otherwise, transformation is like that. You know, it's very, very simple. People come and then sometimes they, like Papaji. Papaji went to, climbed up the steps and Ramana Maharshi just turned and looked like this. He did not even touch him. Standing there, he became enlightened. And Ramana Maharshi walked away. He walked away. He was going to take his bath. You know, Papaji just came up and Papaji did not even speak to him. His problem. His problem was emptiness. He suddenly became blank. He was chanting and he forgot the chant. Chant means there was no mind, no storage box to produce any word. When that happened, big time suffocation, confusion. So he climbed up the steps and he saw Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi just turned and looked. Standing there, he became enlightened. This is the point. This is what it is. You know, so why we are not able to catch that spiritual fulfillment or the pinnacle of spirituality? Because where is the emptiness? You know, almost 2 years ago, 2014, I decided, actually I'm being very nonsensical in this world. You know, actually, what am I doing in the world? People are coming. Most people come with their insecurities. And I hate to pamper insecurity because I like to empower people. Insecurity is something which is a projection of the mind. So I do not like to pamper. So I, that time, Vittal Babaji, he was a pontiff of Sripada Sri Vallabhapuram, the first incarnation of Lord Datta. He was the pontiff there. So I don't know why suddenly he was calling me and said, I want to meet you. So my programs were going on and I was busy. He insisted you fix a time, a date. So finally we fixed the date and then I went there. Then I never ask any guru anything. I never ask them anything. Whatever, all I can produce is empty cup, which I produce, and whatever gets filled in is okay. This is my habit. Whenever I go to any master or any place, my job is to go empty. I don't even check how much I'm getting, what I'm getting. So I went to him and I told him, Babaji, I want to speak to you privately. He looked at me, he laughed. You have a problem? I said, I have no problem, but I don't know what I'm doing in this world. Everybody is talking and a lot of people are talking, nobody is listening. And why should I talk to people? I like to withdraw because actually when I was working earlier, I used to meditate for long hours and I used to have silence and sufficient money, there was no problem. So now this talking is becoming a thing because you are not compelled to talk. Talk is happening as per the audience. So I was thinking, why should I make more sound? You know, this noise was annoying me. So I said, I need permission to withdraw from public life. Then he said, why you are tired now? So I said, I think I'm talking nonsense about what am I giving to the world? Then he said, what did you think I did all my life? Then he said, this is not your question. This is not your prerogative. If you are sent, do your job. Don't think. You're not supposed to think. You're supposed to deliver if you are sent. So, niyoga. What is your niyoga? Fulfill it. And then he said, then I told him, but Babaji, I have nothing to give to people. People are coming with questions like, when will my daughter get married? Or when will my son have a promotion? I said, this is not my job to tell, you know. I'm not an astrologer. So so I said, nobody is coming with a real cause like I want to evolve to the level of emptiness. Nobody's asked. I said, Babaji, I have nothing to give. I'm empty. He said, this is exactly what you have to give. Give emptiness to people. People are already full, filled up. Now give them emptiness. This is your job. Go out and give emptiness. So he didn't allow me to withdraw. But the point I'm saying is that the biggest gift any guru can give to any disciple is freedom. That's it. Nothing more you can. Knowledge is nothing. Knowledge will happen from inside. What you need knowledge is like a navigator. From here, how do you reach home? If the navigator is there, you can go home. There's no problem. Knowledge will happen as per the requirement. Unnecessary knowledge is obesity. You can gather so much of information. Like there are thousands of books about Kundalini, but that will not make your Kundalini rise. Unless you reduce your weight and the alignment happens, Kundalini experience will not happen. And also there is another problem. If you read all these materials and you decide that your Kundalini experience should be like this, then you have a problem. That is where people are getting stuck many times. So all these things are understand that life has to be spontaneous. Life has to be natural. And there is nobody exactly like you. So your experience is 100% unique to you, and it must be. There's no other way that you cannot counterfeit or you cannot borrow somebody else's experience. I had this experience. That is called faking. It never works. Mind projects, like people had witnessed Lord Krishna, Lord Jesus. All this witnessing happened. And then I asked one question. What transformation happened after this witnessing? If you became totally empty, if your frequency became higher, and you are totally empty and you need nothing from this world, then you actually had an encounter. Because if you are connecting to a master of that caliber, he would completely wipe you out. Did it happen or you had a good time? If it's a good time, it's mind's projection. Simple. You know, you can have any encounters that way. Mind can project one after the other. It's like a movie, feature film. Nothing happens when you get out, you know. Just some impressions, some memories, that's it. Film is over and you're out. This is exactly many of these spiritual experiences we talk about. If you actually had an encounter or a connection with a master of power, you would not exist. That frequency would have shifted your whole frequency into a level of emptiness where you don't exist. You know? So these are all things. I think I'm talking too much on each question, so I'll speed it up. How the free will work in your destiny and how to listen to the free will? I think I answered this question spontaneously. How do you select the best meditation practice for yourself? Actually, it's individualistic. And I would say the best meditation is being with yourself. This is what I feel. You know, rather than having a program or a method or somebody's course, I would like you to spend time with yourself. Try to know yourself a little bit more. You know, like one Iranian lady was sending me a message. I mean, she was in a bit of a crisis. So I told her, I said, Moji, I want a quick remedy. I said, feel your face. Have you actually felt your face? You've seen your face in the mirror, but have you felt it? So don't look at the mirror. Start feeling. And then she said, oh, there is a creation in it. I said, yes. Now you explore the creation. How did your nose and eyes and ears are all in that place? You know, go within. And then after some time, now she has reached a level of silence where she is very peaceful. So it's actually, first level is being you, connecting to you, feeling you, understanding you, recognizing you, and also plunging into you. I think this is the best meditation you can ever have. And for which, you need only one ingredient, bit of patience, some saburi. You know, it's easy to borrow food from the processed food is very easy, but processed food never helps your digestive system, right? Because digestive system becomes useless with processed food. But raw food, it's not as tasty as the processed food, but it suits you, your system, because you are raw originally, and raw food helps you. Likewise, this is a bit of a difficult path, but it will definitely take you to the state of Shiva. When I say Shiva, not the person sitting with the snake, etc. It's a state where you are in bliss. That is possible when you know yourself. And this is possible in one lifetime. For sure. This is possible. Provided, have a bit of patience. Spend time with yourself. don't look at other people's approval or other people's opinion about you, which it doesn't matter. You know, I can decide whatever you are. It doesn't matter really, because whatever my opinions are good, only good enough for me about you. But you are you. You see, it doesn't matter. So if you cut down or cut off all these kind of external stuff and start feeling you, thinking about, and also start analyzing, are all my activities, whatever I'm doing today, is it worthwhile? Is it compulsive? This is a big question you must ask yourself. Is it a compulsive activity? Why am I doing this particular thing now? You know, start questioning. Don't question outside people. Don't question another person. Question yourself. Because this is self-exploration. Meditation is not an activity. Please understand clearly. Meditation is not an activity. It's a state. A state of meditation where you are dissolved into yourself. This is why this idea of meditation has been violated too much. What we heard now, it's not meditation. It's actually a communion with yourself. What we experienced earlier, the power of purity, is not a meditation. I call it meditation to avoid all the questions about what is communion, and then I had this communion and all these things. So meditation, okay, people leave it as it is. It's a meditation, no problem. Because people like to make concepts. People like to make frames. So we have to take people off the frames and say, this is you. Now you meet yourself. Once you meet yourself, there's nothing else to meet. Then everything is your reflection. There is no world outside if you do not exist, right or wrong. You know, there's no world outside if you have no life. So everything is a projection. Projection means, of course, there are, when you're eating food, you're definitely eating because it's going into your belly. But all the intakes is up to you, whether it is food for the body, emotion for the mind, knowledge for the intellect. Any point in time, anything can become your reason for obesity. Emotional obesity is very much possible because we are in the age of soap operas. You know, trash is given in bulk and we buy it. So everything has that kind of effect on us. So it is important to meet you, understand you. And I think that is the best practice as far as any being is concerned. Then you can take cue from other masters or whichever meditation suits you, provided you have met yourself. If you have not met yourself, this is the first thing you need to do. If you have not recognized yourself, that's the first thing you need to do, because there's no other way you can move forward. And once you have met yourself, then any meditation, anything is okay. Whatever you consume, it gets digested. Because you are already in tune with yourself. Mind is still with the body. Mind is with the body. Body is in alignment with the mind. Then whatever you take is easily digested. Otherwise, there is already indigestion and you're eating more. So it's just kind of an activity. And that activity only leads to further activity. And mind is occupied, mind is happy. So if you really, really want to progress spiritually, meet yourself first. And understand meditation is not an activity. Meditation is a state where you, when you meet yourself, you become meditative. And that's perpetual. You don't have to sit and meditate. You are meditating always. Mind is still. How to exhale from the imagined hole in our head? This is actually a practice. Like, for example, the gates of our body. Nine holes of our body are supposed the gates of the body. All these are potential gates through which the soul can leave the body. And which gate the soul uses to leave the body determines your next life or your frequency of your next life. Not exactly the prarabdha, even the frequency with which you will take an incarnation, that is determined through the way the soul leaves the body. Like, for example, it's a murder or a suicide, the soul is leaving through the lower region. Definitely for a long time, it is in a dark space. It doesn't even have the power to take a body. That is why sometimes it goes into a body which is already existing, which we call possessed. So, I think most of the people, when they die, they leave through the mouth because there is prarabdha pending. Whenever the soul is leaving through the mouth, that means there is a life pending or few lives pending. That means prarabdha is not over. There's a continuity. Sometimes there is a possibility of the soul leaving through the eyes, which is actually very close to the third eye. So it is. It means that it is already in a state where it may take a life or so, but it's with more awareness. But here, if you leave the soul leaves the body through the space on top, that's exactly the way it came in. That means leaving at will. That means the soul is leaving at will and with full control. And that time, okay, I have done enough, everything is done, and the soul is withdrawn. Then, how do we know? See, most people, when they leave the body, it's very painful, very painful. They have urine and all these things happen. Why? Because memories, impressions are stored all over the body. Do you know where the soul sits in the body? It's like, where does the oil sit in the coconut or the almond? It's all over. It's activating every cell. So storage also happens in all over the thing. So it's like people who have died or died and come back. They say it's like plucking each hair from the body, that pain. Because so much of storage, and you're the soul, while it's leaving, it's compiling all what has to be collected. Basically, there are impressions which are stored, and they're collecting and packing it and taking it. So there is already cabin baggage and check-in baggage and everything. A lot of baggage. So this is when you have more baggage, you have a lot more trouble, and sometimes you have to pay a lot of money also to get the baggage through. So, but if you are kind of not stored much and you are in a relaxed in a way where there is not much desires, not much storage, you just have one baggage to carry. That is your constitution, your character, your personality traits. These are the only things to carry. In that way, you can just take the cabin bag and go. And when you are going through the top of the head, you don't even have cabin baggage. Nothing to carry. Empty-handed you came, empty-handed you leave. Probably you never came empty-handed. You brought the prarabdha, the pending desires, which you put in the body and experienced. But when you are leaving through the top of the head, you are carrying nothing back. Everything is done, finished. So that is an exercise when you are being aware of the top of the head, you know, the Sahasrara. So when you are breathing in that mode, you are being aware that this. So that is it's a imaginary hole we are creating here. So if you practice that, it helps your vertical breathing. In vertical breathing, your detachment, like for example, if I'm keeping like this, or a table is vertical, you can't keep anything on top. So whatever is there, it falls off. But if it is horizontal, maybe something can be kept here. So our regular life is horizontal on parallel to time, but we are trying to do a vertical existence. So this is another side of it. Or had a bad experience about something, you project it on everything, which is similar. Then what happens? Your responses or reactions. The response is always from the intellect. It is non-violent. Reaction is always from the emotion, the mind, which is violent. Yeah. Understand, this is the two way which we which we are operating every day. One is reaction from the mind, and the other is response from the intellect. Response is never violent. If you constantly respond, that means you already have a intellect and mind is quiet. And intellect, okay, this is happening. Somebody abuses you, you respond. When you respond, there's no violence to it. That person will stop abusing because you're only responding. But if you're reacting, it flares up. It gets aggravated. So reaction and responses are two aspects of our daily existence. Which faculty you are using, that will be the result. So when you're not able to express kindness to somebody, that means you have stored certain impression and you are projecting it on that people. That is why I said, only when you dilute your personality with awareness, then only you can be fresh with everybody every moment. Otherwise, it is always a case where reaction or respond, reaction or response. This is usual. That means there is no particular effort in it, because you by nature you are in that mode. You are just doing it. When you do life, this is the result. When you be life, it is different. That is what I said in the beginning. Be life, feel life, you know. So there will be no particular character trait which is overwhelming. You will you will look at the same life. Okay, life is happening. This is fine. You know, so in that case, you're always flowing. You're flowing and you're fine with that flow. This I think as I've been attending spiritual workshop retreats. I've done that. How can one open up themselves to blessings? You don't have to open up to blessings. Blessings are there. Grace is like your sunshine, you know, but you have to open the windows to see there is a sunshine. So what is the way you can open up the windows? By having faith. And what can you have faith on? Number one, yourself. The best and the easiest and the most important faith is to yourself. And when I say yourself, this is where you have to begin the journey. We may have faith in a God outside. This is also sometimes escapism. And we put ourselves too much on a God outside and think that God is coming to help. Of course, bhakti has value. I'm not saying it doesn't have value. But again, whenever you are weak, your expressions are also weak. How can you be strong? Have firm faith in yourself, at least your existence. I'm alive and I'm fine to be alive. And it has nothing to do with others' opinion. Others can say anything they like and others can decide whoever you are. Even if they say, oh, you're a donkey, it's good. It's okay. Because this is their opinion. And they can have their opinion, and which should not affect us. So have faith in yourself. Have faith in your own existence. And then you have faith in the divinity which runs the show. Third level. So once you have the divinity, once you have the faith in the divinity which runs the show, that is the petrol of the car. Petrol of the car is your soul. And your soul and the petrol has no interest in any destination, but it helps your journey. Minus petrol, you cannot drive the car. But petrol never demands a particular destination. Petrol never says, I need to go here. Petrol helps your journey. So your soul is neutral and completely in a tranquil mode, and it needs no awareness to grow or develop. It is just aiding your journey, just like petrol of the car. Have faith in that. This is your primary guru. Your biggest and primary guru is your own being, your own soul. That is only, you can only connect to the soul when you be, when you feel, when you empty. You know, all the sounds are happening in the mind. So much of calamity. Remove all the calamities and see what is not affected by any of these calamities. Then you reach the soul. That's the only time when you start connecting to yourself. Otherwise, we are just sponsoring to sounds. When you go to some place, when you go to an activity, when you get involved in an activity, you're sponsoring to more and more and more sounds. And when you sponsor to more and more sounds, you're getting more and more agitated. You're dissatisfied. Why there is dissatisfaction? Because mind, by nature, is turbulent. Mind means movement. Mind is movement. When your mind is always on a move or a movement based, when there is no movement, mind is agitated. But actually, what is your truth? Zero movement. Stillness. That is only available with your being, with your soul, for which you need to connect. And when you are connected to your soul, grace is like a sunshine. It constantly flows. Understand, no guru has priorities. No guru needs anything from you. No God needs anything from you. Even your puja. You know, even your bhajans or chanting, God is not interested. Actually, you're making a lot of noise. God is annoyed with all this. But what actually you need is to feel the power of God. God, we call God the energy, which is the basis of every creation. Anything which is moving and not moving have the same energy. Like, don't think that this table has no energy. You go to the molecular level and the atomic level, you can see the vibration. So everything is vibrating, everything has a frequency, and that frequency is God. Unless you connect to the tiniest and the micro point, you will not see God and feel God. So this is your attempt for spirituality. What you are trying to do is to be you and go to the core of you where you can actually experience God. Then it's only grace, nothing else. Only grace. If you have your senses to listen today, it's grace. If you are breathing today, it's grace. I was replying to one person recently. Give me one reason for me to be alive. I said, the reason is that you are alive. You know, tell me, because that lady was depressed. said, give me one reason why I should be alive. I said, you're alive. That's the one reason. Then I can give you more reasons. I said, you're breathing. You have a shelter. You have food to eat. You have money. You know, you have a vehicle to drive. Isn't this enough reason to be alive or to be happy? Now what do you need? Now even if, like, imagine you got $1 million, but still your stomach capacity is the same. Don't think that so many new things can make you more happy. It's not so. It's a mind thing. But if you are able to add value to the world outside, you will be rich always. See, your richness is purely dependent on how valuable you are to the world outside, not how much you are consuming from the earth, which everybody is doing. 7.3 billion people are eating, and all the animals, birds, everything is eating from earth. What are we giving to the world? We never think that way. Karma yoga purifies you better than any activity. But karma yoga cannot give you liberation. But purity can give you liberation. So karma yoga is an essential part of every religion. Karma yoga means selfless service, activity without selfishness. This is important for every religion because it purifies you much more than any other activity. You know, so it takes you to a level when you take one decision. Take one decision. I will give back to earth much more than I take from earth. This is the only decision that you need to make. Every activity become oriented to karma yoga, selfless service. Once you start moving in that line, other things will fall in place. Because your value grows in the society, because you are not selfish anymore, and then the love which flows into you brings all the grace into you. Grace comes in abundance, because a selfish person can never ask for grace. The more selfless you become, it's only grace. Everything comes to you. Now, our people were starting in Bombay, they were starting the Annadan. So they said, Mohanji, we are not sure about the funding. I said, start it. Funds will come. Till now, no stop. Everything is flowing. All the children, now in Pune, they have started the Angan for slum children. This is also happening. It's not because we have bank balance, but nature makes sure it happens. What I'm saying is that take only one decision that you will add more value to the world than what you take from the earth. You know, through our emotions, through our appetite, we are consuming a lot, but we should give back much more. This is the way to go. So grace is spontaneous. Grace flows provided you want nothing from here. I'm already doing TM for last 20 years and find it quite effective and fulfilling. What is your view about it and your advice to such meditations? Well, I never ever in world or in life say something is right or something is wrong, because see, I'm nobody to say that. I'm nobody to say some guru is better than the other or some method is better than the other. I see that everything has value in this world. This is my opinion and this is what I feel. Now, if you've done TM for 20 years, that means you have liked it. You have, I think, so I have to cut short on the answers. TM for all these years, I think it is good for you. Because actually, why not? But what I would like you to think is, two things. One is, how much emptiness you have achieved inside. See, the clear sign of spiritual progress is fearlessness and silence inside. So this nobody else can tell. People can have their opinion, but inner silence you cannot see, which you feel that whatever happens, I'm very much empty inside. I'm peaceful. So this, if you have achieved, this is definitely effective. If it is not achieved, fine-tune it in such a way that you start shedding more, like what I explained. Emotions are coming, shed the emotions, and again do the practice, because practice has nothing to do with it. It's also to do with your constitution. Because if you're not letting go and you're practicing, you're adding one more habit. You know, so think whether you are adding one more habit or you are actually living it so that you are attaining the emptiness and fearlessness. These are the two signs which you can trust for any spiritual progress, any path. But my personal opinion is all the gurus of the world, all the programs of the world has value to somebody. So we have no right to say something is good or something is bad. My general criteria for good and bad is something which binds you, gives you fear, is not good for you. A guru or a method or a practice which binds you, controls you, or gives you fear is not so good. Because actually you are working on the fear basis. Fear is anti-liberation. Fearlessness is liberation. You will be totally fearless because there is nothing to fear, nothing to be afraid of. So this is my general guideline about whether a guru or a method or a path is good or not. Because some people create a lot of fear to bind. You know, then there is something else going on. This is not liberation. So that, just be careful. Otherwise, there is no problem with any method or any guru or any path of spirituality. You choose what suits you. Like I cannot say that this is the shirt size you should buy because it suits me. It may not suit you. So you buy what suits you. So this is, and it's a prerogative of every disciple. Upanishad says, the guru that comes to you is the one for you. So this is one, so some method has come to you, practice it. Question two, for a spiritual seeker, apart from meditation, there should be tapa, sumiran, seva, I think. Orientation, again. If a person is oriented to bhakti, devotion, then all these matters, even a small thing can trigger the ultimate in them. So, nobody is one thing. Everybody is a complex character. So, a part of karma yoga, a part of bhakti yoga, a part of jnana, all this helps. Now, what ingredient you are, what suits you, this is the main thing. I should not say that you should, of course, if somebody follows me, I guide them. That's in a different way. But tap is your daily life. You cannot run away from your daily life and do tapas. Penance should happen when you are not attached to the results of activity. Then renunciation is spontaneous. Exact renunciation is non-attachment to the result of activity. This is renunciation, not going away into the forest or elsewhere. Why people go away to the forest is because to avoid contamination. But if you are a grihasthi or if you are a householder, this is not the method to accept, follow. So I would say that everything, tab or sumiran or seva, everything should be done within your constitution, capacity and position. And then it is fine. But if you try to imbibe something which is like somebody else's thing, it will never be yours. It is always somebody else's idea. You know, even an idea or a concept, if you're just trying to absorb it from elsewhere, it's somebody else's. Yeah.
Since I joined service in 67,
yes. 10%
of my salary.
That's good.
It has helped in meditation and all that.
Yeah. No, it is good. I mean, that's what I'm saying. It's individualistic. I never say that something is absolutely right or wrong. See, for example,
it works.
Because when you give 10%, you are already expressing a non-attachment to the money part. Non-attachment is renunciation. So the non-attachment is working. It helps. Everything helps, provided you are aware of what it is, you know. So that's it. But many people tell me, I have no money to do charity. I said, that's absolutely non-understanding. You have time to do charity. You have knowledge to do charity. This is, charity is something you give what you have in abundance, not that what you think you must do. What's the cause of widespread cancer and depression in India today? How can it be addressed? Well, number one, there are few reasons for it. One is any illness, ailment happens because of blockage of energy. And how does energy get blocked? Because you are suppressing emotions, suppressing or the feelings and suppressions and various things are stored inside. Whenever there is a storage and there is no circulation of it, means there is no free movement of energy, there is always a blockage, and that blockage creates an ailment. This is one of the reasons. Now, why there is a lot of depression today is because the education system has made people to run more than their individuality. They are not worried about the individuality of the person. Everybody is created as a kind of another brick on the wall. So that all you have to do is just run and win the race. You know, and often what happens, people cannot accept failure. People commit suicide. We see that. Because failure is completely unacceptable to the society. And if they feel that the society doesn't accept them, then they go to the extreme. Likewise, if you look at the society, nobody is happy because the main thing what they are feeding is the emotion. Media sells emotion. All the soap operas, all the novels, programs, television, everything is giving you inputs which are of emotional nature. So when you sponsor emotions too much, depression is the result. The spiritual quotient is very, very low. Spiritual means not. There are a lot of religious quotient. That is what is creating all the wars outside. My religion, his religion, this religion, that religion. That is creating a lot of confusion outside. But spirituality, as I said, religion is only a method to reach spirituality. But this spirituality is missed. So true spirituality is not addressed. If a person is truly spiritual, he'll be kind, he'll be compassionate, and he will be satisfied with what he has. You know, there will be no depression. If you are dissatisfied with what you have, then it's a problem. But how do we address it? Very, very simple. Increase the awareness. First of all, we already have the lack of awareness that it's a human world. It's not a human world. The world belongs to every being, every species. Humans have occupied the whole world. And it's a mercy of the humans so that the other species survives. So we start from there. The coexistence concept itself, coexistence, being one with the whole species, all beings. From there, we have to have a fundamental change in the outlook in the education. We had it in India until the British came and destroyed the backbone of Indian education with the destruction of Sanskrit, number one. Sanskrit is not a language, it's a culture. There was a culture which is destroyed with the destruction of Sanskrit. Like that, if you look at the whole, like this cow slaughter thing was going on. I never saw anybody talking the truth of what it was. I was thinking, what is the big deal about it? Why the ancient saints, ancient rishis supported the preservation of cows? There was no other animal's dung, they said, you can use as an antiseptic and you can use to pave the ground and have a clean space. No other animal's dung is used, including human. And a cow is supposed to be similar to a tree. A tree absorbs all the carbon dioxide and releases oxygen. A cow, in its 15 years of life, it is supposed to absorb all the negativities from the society, but it leaves the dung which is pure. Means it stores everything and keeps it in the body. That is when they say, if you eat that meat, you are eating all the contamination of the world. And also it's an injustice to the animal which is preserving you. Just like you cut a tree. When you cut a tree, you are actually cutting down your option for oxygen. So if you slaughter a cow or a bull, this is the only species which can actually absorb all the negativity but release only the positive, which is the dung or the urine is good for Ayurvedic medicines. It's milk and the butter and all these things are edible. So this kind of being is not there. So that's why you should respect cows, because they are being good to you. And they are always on a meditative, non-aggressive. So they are leaving. And that is why if you look at the Kamadhenu, there is a god in every portion of its body. Because so many, each deity has a character and a constitution. So each part of the body of the cow has a character and a constitution which absorbs that negativity into its body. That is why it is positioned in that way. This is what has been told by rishis, but I never heard anybody talking about it. They were debating whether we should kill cows or not, which was very silly. Very, very silly. See, why did we lose all this tradition? When did we lose it? When we started looking outside. If you look inside, you have the answers. This is nothing. I'm not saying this is rocket science. This is just logical. Otherwise, why did all the rishis have this? And even in our house, it says that when you are, have a cow and a calf, and when you have cows in the house, it's always automatically protects all the entities from coming inside. The people are healthy because they absorb all the negativity, and they store it. Then they die and they leave it. So it's in a 15 years, they remove a lot of things. This is what I've been told by the saints. We must understand the truth behind all these things, you know, so that there'll be no confusion. But why no other animals are in that category? Because they don't have that capacity, including humans. How do you explain unexpected death? Unexpected for whom? You know, unexpected, there's nothing unexpected. It's time is up, you go, pull the plug. Please tell us about healing techniques to help cure sickness. I don't know how to explain healing techniques. There are numerous techniques, Reiki, pranic healing, etc. I think everything is of value. But only one thing, please understand, to all the healers, as a general instruction I always give around the world, the more you get emotionally involved with the patient, you attract that illness. This I have seen in the aura of a lot of people. You attract that effect of the illness and it stays with you. And the person will be happy. He'll be healed because you have collected it, right? So when you heal, please understand you are only being a medium. You are being a channel. Stay as a channel and heal the person. Then you must say, if it is karmically okay, let the person be healed. That should be your attitude. Your attitude should be good for sure, definitely. It is to help the people. But always understand that you are not healing. Healing is happening through you and you are just a channel. If you remain as a channel, and if you remain objective and neutral, this is okay. Otherwise, you will be a baggage of garbage, you know, and you wouldn't know what to do with it. This is surely giving you more life of not being a healer of a sick person, because this is what you are carrying. Each soul comes with a life plan. If a soul completes its life plan within the lifetime, of course they complete the lifeline with the life, because you already taken the number of breaths, the kind of money you need for the supermarket. It's already, you have to complete it within this lifetime. There's no other way. Because of the individual spiritual development in the lifetime, can the next incarnation start in the current life itself? Possible. This is a good point. This can happen in one life also. See, like for example, Kuppuswamy became Sivananda. At one point in time, one lifestyle is finished, another took off. Same body. In astrology, it is called death. In astrologically, if you say, oh, you're supposed to die at this time, but you will not physically die, you would have changed your track. You know, astrologically, I'm supposed to die at 35. Now I'm 51. You know, so, but the life changed at 35. So this is possible. Definitely possible, because what you were until then, you stop being, and then you are in a different track. Completely different mode. And people who knew you before will not even understand what this fellow is doing. That person is dead, is finished. Now it's a different being. And that is because the purpose changed. So instead of taking two lives, you sometimes finish in one life. This is definitely possible. Can the next incarnation start in the current life itself? Yes. Or unless this is destined, it will not happen. Yeah, correct. Absolutely. Again, intellectual question. That's okay. But there's method in this question. It is definitely possible. And sometimes, you know, your baggage is so less, means, and one more life, like for example, there are soul mates, right? A group of souls come together and experience life together. Degree variations, sometimes a few days, sometimes a few years, sometimes a whole lifetime. So the father, mother, brother, all the people who are associated, they're all soulmates. All of you are soulmates of mine as well. That's why we are all together. So our duration might be different, but we have a soulmateship in this. So in this whole path, we sometimes decide that it is not sufficient, it's not sufficiently required to take a full incarnation. So that in this life, it's more or less over and there is only one death possibility. Okay, might as well use the same body so I don't have to come back again, because your attachment to your mother of this life or father of this life or the relatives are gone while living. It's all finished. Like some souls who have come back and said that I had done with this family. Why did I come back here again? So what has happened is with the death experience, they cut off the link with this current family. Then they are coming back as an alien, as a new person. So the other relatives will not understand it, because they will think that what is this person talking. But what has happened is that you have lost the link and you have come into a different mode. So this is fine. This is absolutely fine. But that is, again, it's not a physical personal choice, not a mental choice for sure. What happens is the possibility is high. The possibility is very high. So what happened? One body is continued. And again, then when will you die? Never know. Then the purpose takes over. Usually this is not karmic life. It is dharmic life. It's not prarabdha. You know, it's a dharmic life. But the constitution you maintained, character you maintained, personality you maintained. But life is different. Even the personality shifts sometimes. Kuppuswamy was not the same as Shivananda, right? It was a different person or a complete different personality. You know? So this is how it is. I think we overshot time. Thank you. Suma is hungry. Thanks to you, all of you. And thanks to Suma. Thanks to Karthikeyan sir. Thanks to Aditi sir.